You're listening to Bang 103.6 FM. It's the Tuesday Night Link Up, B Money and Ramel London, and we have special guest in the building today. It's Mr. Michael Payne.
Yeah.
How you
doing,
bro?
Yeah, good, thanks.
You know what? I just want to say this is the first interview. Well, no, sorry. We scratched that word. We never say interview no more. This is the first link up of its sort. We've had a lot of rappers, a lot of trappers, but you're not quite. What are you?
I'm just a songwriter, mate. I just write songs. I happen to predominantly rap, but I do, you know, I write all my own mid-lates, my own hooks.
Wow.
So I can't just, I'd be doing myself an injustice if I was to say I'm just a rapper, innit?
Yeah.
So I'm just a songwriter, man. I write a cheeky song here and there, and that's about it.
Yeah.
Definitely. Like I've seen you. I think it's as soon as I got back to London, because I was in uni in Leeds, so I think it's about 2010 for me, I was trying to find out what's going on in London, and literally everywhere I went, I saw you. If it wasn't at an event, like I remember when you used to hit me up to say, oh, I love live, yeah, what's going on? Because I used to be like the little promo girl.
Poster girl.
And you were like, yeah, what's going on at I Love Live? So I see you all the time at shows like that. And then like Urban Development, they were getting you to be like a narrator like big shows like Redefinition?
The Redefinition. Yeah,
Redefinition.
2 years in a row.
Yeah. It's like you were just more than just an artist. You were, people respected your craft and like the way you use your words. And like, I've always kind of seen it as you've always been ahead and more than just a rapper. Like you said, you're a songwriter and you put a lot into it. But like, what have you always kind of, what direction have you wanted to take your music in? Because you're a rapper, but you're not conventional in the slightest.
Artist.
Yeah, that's it. I want people to see that I see this thing artistically, innit?
Yeah.
I don't see it as a means of, when I write a song, I don't see it as, I don't hear, the crisp notes that I'm hopefully gonna get like for a live show or whatever. I don't see that. I just see the how can I sort of express myself artistically, and it's all. I say nowhere in your first line.
A siren just went by.
Yeah. But yeah,
soundproof windows.
So called. I just try to express myself and myself only.
Yeah.
So when people ask me who are your influences, I might sound arrogant, but I always say no one, because I try
Fair enough.
To be influenced by people.
Sick.
Which isn't to say that people aren't worthy of being inspirational. They're not, but I don't want to sound like anyone. I just want to sound like myself, so that people know that they either love it or hate it, and they know that they either love it because of me or hate it because of me, and I'm purely to credit or to blame.
It reminds me of a post I see a lot on Instagram these days. If anyone can have it, I don't want it.
Yeah. I suppose it's similar to that, but it's just more profound now, because I find with Instagram posts, people try to like, especially with these memes and stuff, it's just like people try and sound like as profound as possible, but then it just ends up being super cliche because everyone's posting the same thing. But I think the most important thing is just to be yourself, man.
Yeah.
Because everyone is slightly different to everyone else. It's as simple as that.
You are my favourite Instagrammer. Favourite, because the way you use like puns and the way you use your words, and like just a simple thing of like, oh, what was it? When you done your London leg of your tour, you got all, was it the London leg? You got everyone to put their shoes up.
Yeah, every gig. But basically, I've got this song called Heart and Soul on the You Guessed It EP, which is a free download, shameless plug there.
Yep.
MichaelPayne.com, MikellPayne. Basically, I've got this free EP, and there's a song on it called Heart and Soul.
Yeah.
And it's basically just all the double entendres that I can find with relating to shoes and sex.
Yeah.
The song's very sexy. It's got like a 90s R&B vibe to it, and it's got Paloma Faith on the hook.
Yeah,
she's a very sexy woman. She, you know, she's got the whole burlesque and the whole like massive sort of a theatrical sort of a production thing going on, and she's just amazing.
Yeah.
Especially from, you know, a young girl from Hackney as well.
Yeah,
that's
what
a lot of people know. And so we did this tune, and you know, to pay homage to this tune, I just got everyone to take off one shoe and just hold it in the air. But you know, I'm not the first person that's ever done it. Obviously, Run DMC
made
it.
Adidas, and that's how they got the original Adidas.
And Mike Skinner did it as well.
Yeah.
As well with Reebok. So I was, you know, obviously I love Nike, and you know, so I was hoping everyone would put up a Nike shoe. But you know, people had their Vans on, and people have other brands.
You're messing with my endorsements.
But it was cool. It was all good, man. Like just the fact that people were open-minded enough to do it. Do you know what I mean? You couldn't do that at like I don't know. Rick Ross couldn't do that to his fans. He'd be like, "What do you mean, take my shoes off, Kyle?
Put your chicken wing up."
Do you know what I mean? But no one would want to take off their shoes because, do you know what I mean? Everyone's just super stush and I don't know. I just can't imagine someone like Rick Ross being able to do that.
But speaking of your tour, you've literally just finished.
Your
2014 February tour. You kind of extended it a little bit.
By a date. Yeah, I just had like, you know, a promoter tag in and ask if we could play Lincoln. So that was the new last date. And, you know, the Lincoln crowd were amazing. We had like a stage invader.
What?
We got wrestled to the ground.
What?
But I'll show you the video after. It's brilliant. Oh, so this kid, he wasn't even the kid. He was, this guy's like a full-fledged adult man. He was like, must have been like 19, 20. He, obviously Arsenal, thankfully beat Liverpool yesterday in the FA Cup. So he's getting on it in the bar before the gig. And he's asking all the security if he can watch me sound check.
Okay.
But for some reason, it was quite weird. That was the one night on the tour that I chose not to sound check. I got my tour manager to sound check for me. It was weird. I just decided I didn't want to sound check.
Yeah.
So anyway, he didn't get to see me sound check. So during the gig, I'm like sort of introducing the next song, and then I just feel like just a whole pint of beer just wash over me. I'm indoors, so I know it's not urine. Do you know what I mean? If I was at a festival, I'd have been like, I don't even want to like lick my face right now, just to say, do you know what I mean? I know it's going to be salty and warm as hell, this was cold, so I knew it was beer.
Yeah.
So I've looked up, and this dude, he's thrown the rest of his beer at me, but he's just like, I love you so much.
Okay, that's
and I'm like, yeah, for real. So I'm like, no, I'm not going to let you get away with throwing beer on me.
Drunk in love.
So I've got my, I've got my ginger beer, my rum and ginger beer, and I've just told him to stay there. And he stood there, and I just thrown my drink in his face, innit? Yeah.
But then
he's like jumped over the barriers. He's run on the stage trying to dance. Believe this quarterback-looking security guard. He was just onto him straight away. Rugby tackled him to the ground. He's just got him in some weird neck lock. But this guy's, believe this boy's so wasted that he's just busting up. He's just laughing for the whole, like manically laughing, not just like sniggering with embarrassment. He's manically, maniacally. It was weird. And then he just got kicked out. I didn't see him again. But if you watch the video, some of the crowd, I'm not going to repeat what the crowd was chanting to this guy, but it was amazing.
I can only imagine.
I mean, that's wicked. I'm happy you gave us that. But I was going to ask you, what's your craziest tour story to date? Just summarize it for me.
I mean, you've toured with Rizzle Kicks.
Yeah.
Ed Sheeran,
Mac Miller.
Like, there must be some stories.
Yeah, there are ones that I don't know if I can repeat.
Go on, it's fine. It's a link up. It's not an interview.
Just omit the words.
All right, so there was one.
Oh,
wow, I won't mention names, but I was on tour with someone.
Let's try and piece it together.
And okay. Myself and my DJ, because I was on, in fact, not whatever. I was with my DJ, and we've got these two girls in VIP.
Okay.
We're gonna get them back to the hotel.
He's dropping bombs, by the way.
We're gonna get them back to the hotel, but then they see the headline act and decide that me and my DJ aren't good enough, that they wanna both go with the headline act. So then he's apologising, but I don't hate the player. I hate the game, innit? I just got like properly just parred, yeah. They jump in the taxi with this dude,
yeah.
And then on top of that, while they're back at his hotel room, phone up another friend who comes. So he ends up with three, and me and my boy end up with nothing.
So wait. There was a potential where you and your boy could have
got one each.
Yeah, one each.
Been on two and two.
Right, the headline act gets both of us.
3-on-1.
2-on-1. Yeah. Then they phone one of their brethren and he gets a free.
They phoned a friend.
Yeah.
That is mad.
Damn, fam. Yeah. In the words of Giggs, damn, fam.
He was apologising to me. I was like, mate, do you know what? I can't be angry at you. I can't even be angry at them, because why would you go for the support act where, I'm sure it's written in the groupie handbook somewhere, if you're with the support act and then the headliner comes along,
you
automatically abort that mission, and do you know what I mean?
That's how you know he's not a real friend, because I would have said, to get to me, you have to get through them first.
Do you know what? Like I said, do you know what? It was his birthday as well.
Oh, okay, of course, yeah, he has to, yeah.
I need to figure out, so wait, all right. Can I figure it out?
I'm not going
to
tell you it
can
is.
Can I figure it out?
Is he black or white?
I'm not saying anything. I'm not saying anything.
London like, Rundown.
I know, right?
Yeah, London Rundown.
I don't snitch. I don't snitch.
I'm wicked. All right, I want to take you back quickly because you said how you wish you got everyone to put their Nike trainers in the air.
No, any shoes are fine. I just would have liked it, Nike, right?
So let's just talk about Nike for a minute because the day before Valentine's Day, or maybe the day before that, someone stole your Nike trainers.
Yeah. Did you see that on Twitter?
I saw your tweet.
God, I'm absolutely gutted about that. So basically, I come back like for a couple of days on tour because I'm doing the London show. So I had a day off after that. Plus, you know, if you do, obviously I didn't need to stay in a hotel anywhere. I just stayed at my flat. So you know, I go into my flat and I live on the top floor of this apartment block and my neighbours are sweet like family. My neighbours are a sweet family with like a little baby. And you know, the woman is like really lovely and she basically, it can't have been them, right? So I go into my flat and like something just doesn't seem right. So I look, because I'm a massive sneaker collector and I've got like these huge shoe racks and they've got compartments in them for shoes, right?
After that, I want to know where you got the shoe rack from because you've got these white shoe racks.
Yeah, yeah, Argos.
Serious?
Yeah, yeah.
I'm going.
All right. Other retailers are available. I know they say that on Radio 1, innit? They don't want anyone trying to monopolise the tickets.
Nice, so bang, don't worry.
Other high street retailers are available.
Yeah.
So anyway, I go into that and like, you know, I've got my, I've been wearing a pair of gold Air Max 1s, like opening ceremony ones from like the Beijing Olympics. Some footscapes are out. So there's two spaces, two compartments that are accounted for. But there's this one compartment, I'm like, what shoe went in there? What shoe went in there? Could not figure it out. I put all the shoes away. This compartment's still glaring at me. And I realized it was the pewter Jordan 1. Yeah. It's like a dark metallic color with like an orange lining in it. Some arse has stolen a pair from outside my flat, but left like, you know, I had, like I said, the opening ceremony Air Max 1s out there. I had the black and blue OG Jordan 1s out there. They didn't take those, which is lucky, but at the same time, why did they have to take my pewter Jordan 1s?
Maybe they didn't really know about trainers, but they saw the colours and, oh, blah,
yeah, little magpie idiots, innit? Yeah, shiny trainers, they must be super expensive.
And it was the day before Valentine's Day, so you never know what the girl was asking for.
I'm just gutted, man. Every time I leave my flat, I just hope it's a prank and someone's going to put them back.
It's not going to happen, mate. How many trainers do you have?
I've got in the region. See, people are like, pity's going to go out the window for me now. I do have around 700 pairs.
700 pairs?
What's that tiny temple line? I got so many crepes I keep some at my mum's house.
Well, I keep, so I'll have tiny, you know, that I keep some at my mum's house. And my sister's and my mum's other house.
No,
so yeah, no. Tiny's a mate of mine, actually. Tiny's probably got more pairs than I have.
No, I don't believe it. You have the most in the UK. It's got to be at least.
No,
hell no. Got better style.
Kish, yeah. Kish Cash, man. Like, really? He's got over 3,000 pairs, I'd say by now.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay. But he's been collecting since like the. He's a bit older than me, innit? And he had a plaque up in the Victorian Albert Museum.
What?
Mate. He's a big boy, man. Kish is a big boy when it comes to sneakers. He's got stuff from like the 80s, man.
Let me ask you something about collecting trainers, because I don't know if I'm allowed to class myself as a trainer collector, because I buy it, I collect it, I wear it.
Yeah.
I bun them out and I buy a new pair and repeat. So
you throw them away?
No, well, I don't. Yeah, I do throw them away if they're worn out. So are you still an eligible trainer collector if you've worn the creps out? Or do you have to leave them preserved on the shelf?
No, not at all. I don't see the point of buying trainers if you're not going to wear them.
Thank you.
Like, I've never really paid much mind to that whole dead stock thing. Like, you know, don't get me wrong, I've got trainers that I've worn once. Do not get me wrong, because they're very nearly dead stock. But the fact of the matter is, if I buy a pair of trainers, it's because I like it so much that I want to wear it. And you know what I mean? I want to be seen in that shoe. Like I said, even if I only wear it once, I will wear it. Okay. You understand? So I have one or maybe two pairs of shoes in my whole collection that I've never worn.
Yeah,
literally, that's it.
Wow.
And that's the SWAT Air Force Ones. Do you remember the movie, the SWAT?
My mum didn't bring me in on crepes, you know.
But you remember the film SWAT? LL Cool J, Colin Farrell.
Yeah.
So they released this reinforced Air Force One.
What?
It's got like a steel toe cap, and it's a bit higher than the normal Air Force Ones, and everything's reinforced. So instead of the plastic hoop at the end of the strap, it's metal. You know,
it reminds
me
of my duck boots. I got the winterized duck boots.
And like the
whole shoe is like I said, it's like, you know, super reinforced and that. And I don't think I ever wore. I got them for my birthday when I was like maybe 19 or something. Never worn them. Got another pair of what are they again?
Trainers?
Yeah, they are, obviously. But I can't remember, I can't remember the model name, but yeah, I've never worn them either. But just because...
You have so
they're
many.
So, no, it's because these ones are so...
Exclusive.
I don't know what to do, basically. Yeah, I don't know, I don't know how to wear these
you
shoes.
You have to be coming out of spaceships or
it's
thing.
A madness, yeah.
Oh, no, yeah. Cool. Ramel.
Okay, well, do you know what? We're speaking of the whole fashion kind of element of this, and you've always stood out to me. Like, I think it's just because I've just always been, you know, a humble black girl from North London, and like, you kind of introduced me to like real East London kind of Shoreditch kind of look, and like,
you've
really kind of just thrown yourself forward as being an individual. So like, where does it all come from? Like, where does your style, and I mean, being in from Hackney is, I'm sure that's a big part of it, but like, you know, even the tats, like everything, like
I've just I grew up in Hackney. This is the thing, this is one thing well, people know, but the thing about Hackney is that there are a lot of sort of insurgents, if you like, that have come in. There's been an influx of, like, you know, people from out of town that, you know, young trendy people and stuff, and they kind of give Hackney the image that it has today. But I've been in Hackney doing what I've been doing for years now, do you understand? And even when I was, when Hackney was like proper ghetto, I used to go to, like, you know, a really good school when I was younger, and if I told anyone I was from Hackney, they'd think I was going to get them robbed, or just robbed them myself and stuff, do you know what I mean?
That's sick.
You know, Hackney was
that's not sick.
Yeah, it kind of does put you up in the hierarchy. No, I'm joking. No, but on a level, like, Hackney was both good and bad for me. I used to see both the good side and the bad side, do you know what I mean? And I wasn't one of them people who was so high up in the pecking order where I was invincible or anything. Don't get me wrong. Like, you know, it's coincidental. I'm just a humble black boy. Do you know what I mean? It's as simple as that. But I've been doing what I've been doing for a while, and it just so happens that, I don't know, I was just in the right place where people don't really watch me as an individual in my neighborhood, because everyone is kind of creative and everyone is kind of left field a bit, do you know what I mean? But then obviously I've got, like, you know, my old school, like, proper rude boy mates and stuff. They're like, Gus, what are you wearing today, fam? You know what I mean?
It's all
good. Yeah, it's all good.
I think your style's dope. I mean, like, technically, the way you're telling me is that Hackney's like the Harlem world of London in a way, in terms of, like, unique style.
Yeah. East London-ish. Well, when you say Harlem, man, like, even a place like Harlem, people think of, like, ASAP Rocky.
Yeah.
And you know, think Harlem's this place where everyone's wearing, like,
skinny
high fashion stuff.
But it's real
ghetto. Nah, and exactly,
get
not
busy
at all,
out
man.
There, Rich
so,
Porter.
Like, exactly. So, yeah, Hackney is, I suppose Hackney is in a, like,
Harlem-ish.
In, like, in a way, that is, it's interesting you should say that, actually.
And, I mean, what I was going to say is that, I mean, I like your style. I'll be real, because where are your parents from?
My parents are Nigerian.
Exactly. Yeah, so, you know, African boys, sometimes
cool,
your parents...
Cool originated in Nigeria.
Yeah?
Have you, the whole concept of being cool originated in Nigeria.
Oh.
Well, that's another win for us. Yeah. Another W. Thank you. Didn't know that. But
if you ever read a photography book called Back in the Days by Jamal Shabazz.
Yeah.
And the prologue is by Fab Five Freddy.
Yeah.
And, well, I think it's him that writes it. But, yeah, apparently... If you read the introduction to this book, if you read the first few pages, because like I said, it's mainly photography, but if you read the few words that are in the book, apparently, coolness originated in Nigeria.
Speaking of all the people you've been working with, like, you know, on your tour, G-Fresh popped up. Mm-hmm. We also had Meridian Dan.
Man.
Random.
My German wit.
Yeah.
And also
British bus pass.
Rascals on tour with you as well. Where did all these people come from? Like, why have you, like, you've gone from Ed Sheeran, Rizzle Kicks, to then going full-blown grime rappy
again?
Yeah, man.
Like, the thing is, I love music, man. And I love people that, like, these people respect me as much as I respect them.
Yeah.
Do you understand? It doesn't matter about what genre they're, or what sub-genre they're in. We're all MCs, do you know what I mean? But, you know, you've got, like you said, Rascals who are out-and-out grime. You've got G-Fresh who, you know, he's your sort of, like, much more intelligent sort of trap rapper, and you know, but then you've got, like, Meridian Dan again, who's grime, but then like, you know, some of the past collaborators I've collaborated with Rizzle Kicks a couple of times, I've collaborated with Ed Sheeran a couple of times,
examples,
you know what I mean? Like, these people respect me, and I only reciprocate respect, you understand? Like, if someone respects me and I like their music, I'll work with them, it's as simple as that. But I'll only work with someone that I've actually met. You understand?
Okay.
Like, I only work with people. So all these people, I can say that I've been cool with them before we even did music. And I didn't just go, oh, G-Fresh is hot right now. I want to do a tune. I wanted to do a tune with G-Fresh from before. I really, really rate G-Fresh highly. 100%. You understand?
Yeah.
And there are other people that I wanted to work with. that I couldn't because, you know, their schedules didn't fit in with mine. You know, namely like, you know, Creptin Conan, okay. Emily Sande, like, these are all people that were up for it but just couldn't, you know, the schedules weren't, they weren't congruous and stuff. And, but it's all good, man. Like, these people, I know that they respect me enough to work for me, but time is one of the biggest factors in it, in this whole music thing.
Well, you've been working anyway, so, I mean, you're here. Tell us about Blamus Barkley.
Blamus Barkley.
You've been in the bank, you're going to your overdraft and get charged.
I've had Blamus Barkley is my major label experience, if you like.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you know what I mean? Put it out on Virgin EMI, and this tour was, you know, just a little party, basically, to thank everyone who bought it for buying it. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? And it's my first album. It's for me, it's like, personally, it's underexposed, man. Like,
okay.
Conceptually as an album, it's what I wanted to do from the very beginning.
Yeah, can I imagine?
Understand, like, take a load of like different characters and see how their lives intertwine, show people how their lives intertwine and stuff. But the reason it's called Blamus Barkley is because she's the one who first actually put it into my head that I could write creatively and actually have.
Oh, so she's real.
Yeah, she's real. She's my English teacher.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Oh,
yeah.
Sick.
I thought it was just another English play teacher. On words, like,
no,
you
not
know.
At all. Not
she's a real
all.
Lady.
She's a real, like, Miss Lee Barkley.
Oh, bless her.
Shout out, Miss Barkley. Yeah, you put this man
to see
on.
You perform?
No, but we made. There's a documentary that, and I hadn't seen her for 13 years.
Wow.
Before I saw her.
That's
English teachers are dope. My English teacher bought me my first MacBook.
That's what I'm saying.
And iPod.
Yeah.
Matting. Anyway.
What kind of English teacher
back to you,
was
back
that?
To you, back to you, back
all
to
right,
you.
Well, okay, it's got to the part where this is my new kind of segment that I kind of, you know, just fire questions at you. We may just be money. Feel free to get involved. We're just going to try and turn up the heat. Okay, this is the London rundown. Michael Payne, are you ready? Okay, tense. All right. I'm gonna get straight to the chase. Okay, I really want to know, was Ed Sheeran and Taylor Swift really doing a thing?
Not to my knowledge.
Do you still talk to Ed Sheeran?
I do. Spoke to him yesterday.
Okay, cool. Do you have any industry crushes on anybody?
Katie B.
What?
Is she straight?
Nicki Minaj.
Are they?
Okay, oh, okay. So what's the?
The Nicki Minaj one's more than a crush.
Wow.
Bit of an obsession.
Yeah.
Obsession.
Bit of an obsession.
I
what
agree.
Would you do to get Nicki Minaj?
What wouldn't I do?
Matty!
It's easier to answer that one.
Alright, and Katie B, I mean, she's a lot closer to home.
Yeah.
London Rundown.
Yeah, oh, sorry.
There's, I've got a lot
of pressure.
What do your parents think about your music?
They don't like it.
Oh no! Yeah, Nigerian parents.
What do your parents think when you first told them that you're going to do music full time?
They were like, no, seriously, when are you going to become an accountant?
What do they think of your general appearance? You've got a lot of piercings, dude.
I do, and tattoos they
well.
Don't like that either.
Are you in a relationship?
No.
How long have you been growing your beard?
It's how long my beard's been growing me. My beard existed before I did.
Well, you came up beard first.
The beard chose me.
You
I didn't
came up beard,
beard
first, yeah?
Okay, cool. If anything happened to your beard, would you consider trading it in for a beard weave?
No.
What do you think of men?
I don't think that if you can't grow one, you can't grow one. I don't think you should have an artificial beard.
Thank you. That's what I'm. That's the
basically.
Point I keep trying
Sorry.
To make to these people.
Like, it's, I don't know, maybe that women get a blind, like, you know, I turn a blind eye to women who have weave. Cool. Like, that's all about, you know, the sort of glamorous aesthetic, isn't it?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? You want your hair to look longer so that you can sort of flick it about and all that. I understand. Cool. But there's not much you can do with a beard apart from look like rugged, so then you're kind of you're just like jeopardizing your
deep.
Ruggedness if you're going into
so
a salon
jeopardizing
and getting
your
someone to weave a beard into your face.
Yeah, I mean, it could be glued, it doesn't
yeah,
have to
but
be snitched
whatever in. How whatever the procedure is, you're getting someone, no, it's just fake. I'm sorry, I can't. No,
yeah.
Can't condone that.
I mean,
that
we've
at
had
all.
Some serious comments coming in, and like, you know, a friend of yours, Dave from Merkish,
yeah.
he was very, very specific. He said, you know what, sweet boy beards are an oxymoron.
Totally.
So
totally.
A person like Omarion, who's known for being sweet boy, you know,
can't,
bah, bah, bah,
yeah.
He should never.
Nah.
He's not in a position to do such things.
Not at all.
It's for real men.
Real
men,
isn't it? Like,
yeah.
Spend a couple of days in the woods. You know what I mean?
That sounds like a 300 when they send him out to the wolves.
Yeah,
that's
standard.
What I said. It's a coming
like,
of age thing.
You've been through some stuff, yeah. Coming of age. You've
exactly.
been through some stuff. People kind of... No one will go to Omarion for advice. Yeah. Let's be, do you know what I mean?
Girlfriend advice, maybe.
Yeah, but then you can't have a beard and give that, like, nah.
I wouldn't even trust Amara because he's just gyrating too much on
the
stage.
The two things don't blend for me as well.
Well, okay. Well, you've kind of cleared that up for us. Well, we've loved having you here, and we just want to find out what can we look out for the rest of 2014. I mean, you've kicked off 2014 in a big way.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Well, funnily enough, the tour was actually meant to be in October. So.
Oh.
It was meant to be in October 2013, but due to unforeseen circumstances at the time, we had to push the tour back and stuff. But it was still a wicked tour.
Yeah.
And you're right. It did kick off 2014 in style.
Yeah.
So just look out for me live still. Like, you know, I love performing live. I wouldn't care if I spent the rest of my life touring.
Yeah,
I will be putting out more music.
You should.
Definitely.
Nice. Collaborations, Nicki Minaj, Katy B.
Well, that wouldn't be a musical collaboration.
Different type of.
Definitely.
It'd be a Skepta all over the house type of collaboration.
No soundtrack.
So many things I want to say, can't say them.
Don't say them.
Listen, sir, I will let Ramel do her thing, but I need to get my ass kissing out of the way quickly. That's what she calls it. I think if I've heard you perform, I've only seen you perform like once or twice, and that was a long time ago. I haven't totally kept up, but I've always known you're a sick rapper.
Nice.
But this meeting here, like sometimes when you meet someone, it marinates it. You know how you said you want to do a song with someone you haven't met?
Yeah, yeah.
There's a lot of people I won't listen to the music unless I've met them or unless I've seen a freestyle or raw footage. Mm-hmm. So, to be honest with you, mate, I'm a fan.
Nice one.
Earn a fan. Just one more fan to your hundreds of thousands. You got another one, mate. So, definitely we'll be following. Definitely we'll be getting Miss Barclay. Blame Miss Barclay, see how it is. Mm-hmm. And follow to see what you do in the future, man. It's been a pleasure. Probably the best interview I've done so far.
I saw a handshake coming there.
Oh, no, it's coming after, man. It's there.
It's there.
I'll soon be tatted like that, but I'll not watch that.
It's been a pleasure.
100%.
Well, we're going to play another one of your tracks.
Oh, cool. To introduce it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Cool. So, thank you for having me, first of all. And thank you to all the listeners. This is a song from my latest release, you guessed it, EP2. It's free from my website, michaellpaine.com, MIKILLPAME. And it features Sway and Tigger the Orphar, and it's called The Poison.
All right, choosing that link up, B Money Ramon London, bringing you that exclusive Michael Payne link up. Let's get into this. This is The Poison.
If you don't want to miss out on any of our future videos, make sure you subscribe to our channel now.